go ahead and get started. So today I'm talking about growing edible sprouts. So growing edible sprouts is a lot of fun. It's fun, it's easy, and it doesn't require a whole lot of knowledge. It's kind of almost like an entry level, beginner level type of gardening, especially growing something edible. And what I love about it is there's a lot of ebbs and flows in a growing season, especially if you're growing edible plants. So if we're growing squash and tomatoes and cucumbers, there's peaks and valleys, right? So we're gonna have a lot of, you know, successful times and a lot of times where maybe we're not being as successful. Or we've got transition periods where we're going from our summer vegetables, like we're gonna be doing pretty soon here in the fall season, going from, you know, our tomatoes and cucumbers and squash and zucchini, and we're taking those out, and peppers, and we're going into the spinach and lettuce and carrots and turnips and beets and all and radishes and all those fun cold crops that you can do, broccoli and Brussels sprouts. There's so many different things that you can do, and it's a really, really fun time to do that, because as we get cooler weather, it's a little bit easier to work out in the yard. And these crops are actually designed to do very, very well through our fall, winter, even into next spring season. So it gives you another kind of crop and season to do. But in that kind of downtime where you don't have anything to harvest, you can grow this. But I really love to grow them all year. Now, this is something that I just started doing about a month and a half ago. So I'm a newbie to sprouts, but I definitely love it, and it's been a lot of fun. Katie, hello. You're watching from Monroe, North Carolina. Great. Thanks for tuning in. Kathleen from Las Vegas. All right. And then Teresa from Michigan. And we've got Margie from Texas. Awesome. So we've got a really cool topic here. It's really, really fun, and it's really, really easy. And you can do this with a lot of different things. And it's super, super nutritional. I mean, that is one of the things that I've learned from this, is the amount of vitamins. I'm actually gonna hold up some of these seed packets and show you and kind of read to you what these sprouts provide. I mean, they're really, really great. A lot of people say they help with digestion. Some will say that, you know, they're super vitamin rich. They've got a lot of chlorophyll and different things in them. So we'll talk about all that as we kind of go through it. Carol, hello. And Laura, hello from New Jersey. And Karen from Virginia Beach. Awesome. We got a wide range. And that's the cool thing, is no matter what climate you're in, all you need here to grow edible sprouts, is a container to grow them in. And we'll talk about the different options there. And I've got kind of my favorite method. And then you need the sprouting seeds, and you need water. You don't need soil, you don't need fertilizer, you don't need a whole lot of different things in order to accomplish a very, very nutritional and fun and easy snack that are great for salads and sandwiches and soups and stir fry. There's a lot of uses for the sprouts as well, so they're a lot of fun. So we got Trina from Illinois, and Tanya in Kansas, hello, and Robin, hello. So we just keep getting more people in, that's great. All right, so what I wanna talk about first are the seeds. And so we carry these seeds from Handy Pantry. So if you live across the country, you can order these online. If you live in our neck of the woods, definitely come in and check us out. We've got a great little supply of them. They're not super expensive, and they produce a lot. And that's one of the benefits of growing sprouts, is they're very, very economical. So if you ever bought sprouts, sorry, Kathy, if our video is going on and off, we'll try and get that worked out, but we are plugged in direct, so hopefully that continues. Lori, hello. So the seeds are great. These are from Handy Pantry or Fresh Market, or I think it's called True Leaf Market or Handy Pantry. You can look them up online, or you can come in. I hope you come in if you're in our neck of the woods, save you a little bit of the shipping costs. But these are great seeds. They're USDA organic seeds. So they're certified organic for organic production. That means, and also they're non-GMO. So that means they haven't been genetically modified, and they haven't been treated with pesticides or insecticides or fungicides or anything like that. So they're pure seeds. And whenever you buy seeds, you always wanna look for the label on the back. It'll tell you all the contents. So for example, like this is mung bean, and mung bean is 99% pure seed inert matter. Whenever you see inert matter on the back, I talk about this a lot when I talk about grass and lawns, inert matter is dust. So there might be a little bit of dust in there, and that's really dust from the seeds kind of maybe shedding a little bit. But these are really, really pure seeds, and they're also tested for high germination. So we did a lot of research trying to find a really, really good company to go with sprouts, and this is one of my favorites. They have a great selection, and they've got a lot of these little tools as well. So no matter where you live across the country, you can pick these up online, or you can, of course, if you live in our neck of the woods, you can come and see us. And I'll hold these up a little bit better, so hopefully we've got a little bit of a glare, but I'll hold these up so you can see them as we go through them. But they're very, very high quality seeds, and I've had very few that actually haven't germinated. I mean, I've done probably, 10 to 15 batches, and I might find one seed, really like every two or three batches. So really, really great. And they're all food grade, and they're all designed for that. They're also tested for Salmonella and E. coli. So I know a lot of people, if you've ever looked at sprouts before, sometimes there's warnings on the packages about Salmonella and E. coli and things like that. These have been tested, so you know that you're safe and you don't have to worry about it. It's just nice to not have to worry about any of those things. So really, really good seeds. And that's always the most important thing when you're growing edible sprouts, is to find a high quality seed. Let me talk to you about a couple of these different seeds, because I mentioned the nutrition side of it, and I think that's a very important part of this, is how are these seeds. So Karen asked, where are you broadcasting from? We're in Hampton Roads, Virginia. So Karen, I'm not quite sure where you said. I think you said you were in Virginia Beach. So yeah, if you're in Virginia Beach, we're right here in Virginia Beach. We've got two locations, and they both carry these. We've got our location here on Independence Boulevard, and then we've got another location at Great Neck. So go to our website if you want to find those locations. Karen, we'd love for you to stop in and get some sprouting seeds and just check us out if you haven't seen us before. But these seeds are super, super nutritional. They're packed full of things. So let's talk about a seed, first real quick, because I think this is very interesting too, is the seed has everything, for life designed in it. So that's what's so cool about plants in general, is one plant produces tons of seed, right? So, I think a lot of people use the mustard seed. Mustard seed has everything that it needs to survive in that seed. All it needs is the right conditions to germinate. And then it explodes with all these nutrients. It's packed, it's super, super packed. So seeds are really cool just by themselves, but then to sprout them and eat them, you get all that benefit and you get it very quick. And that's what I really love about this, is it's a super quick turnaround time. So let's just go through some of the varieties that we're carrying right now. And there's a whole bunch of different ones out there. I'm gonna tell you some of the ones that I carry, and then I'll kind of do how to sprout them so you can see how to do it. And it's super, super easy. So I'm not gonna waste a lot of your time. This is gonna be a quick kind of short webinar. All right, so this one's lentil. So I'll hold up the package. Let's see if I can get it so that there we go. So these are lentil seeds, and these are from Handy Pantry, as I mentioned earlier. So I'm just gonna read some of these because it tells you a lot about what's in there. Green lentil sprouts are high in fiber, protein, and amino acids. Delicious by themselves or excellent additions to soups and salads. So that's lentils. We've got beans, which are basically green beans, this is mung bean. So mung bean have a crisp, crunchy texture and flavor, similar to fresh peas. They are a tasty addition to salads and Asian dishes. So really, really nice one. And we've got chia seeds, so black chia. Chia are high in calcium, phosphorus, and omega-3 fatty acids that aid in heart and brain health. So that's an awesome one. Sunflower seeds, now this is one that I haven't done yet. Sunflower is apparently amazing as a sprout or as a microgreen. I'm not gonna talk about microgreens too much. That's a little bit more of a complicated. So for us beginners that are kind of starting in this world, I love sprouts, they're much easier. And you can do sprouts with sunflower seeds. So it says sunflower greens are a favorite microgreen or sprout. Added to any salad, sunflower seeds in the shell are best grown in soil, sprouting up with small plump leaves. So sunflower seeds are really cool. We've got fenugreek. So fenugreek is rich in protein, iron, and vitamins A and D. So really, really nice one. Let's see what else we got. We got alfalfa, probably one of the most popular sprouting seeds. Alfalfa sprouts are one of the most popular. Diverse, nutritious, and delicious sprouting seeds. They are easy to grow fresh and flavor pairs with any meal. So that's kind of a very versatile one. We've got radish. Now radish is a good one. Radish sprouts are crisp, slightly hot, and tangy like tiny radishes. So they sprout well with other seeds and add a spicy flavor to any dish. Let's see, we've got five-part salad mix. So this is one of my favorites. This is the one that I started with and I love it. It's got a lot of different things in it. It's got alfalfa, radish, mung bean, lentil, and broccoli. And so this makes kind of a complete salad in itself. They're great thrown onto a salad, and they're great just by themselves. And then the protein powerhouse. So this is another mix. So this one has garbanzo, mung beans, green pea, adzuki, And these are great in stir fry. So these are a little bit bigger. So these are, you can just see the kind of difference there. So this is a 5-part salad mix. You can see the seeds, really, really tiny little seeds. And then you can see the protein powerhouse. And that's really kind of a great way to kind of describe sprouts is by the seed size. The bigger the seed, usually more protein rich. The smaller seeds, more vitamin rich. So they're really, really easy. And I'm going to show you kind of how to do it. And really kind of my most important thing with the seeds is just find good seed. Which one of the sprouts are used in Japanese stir fry meals? So a lot of them are used. I know mung bean is probably one of the most popular, but you can use a lot of them. I know a lot of people use the adzuki and the garbanzo because they're a little bit bigger, a little bit more nutty in the flavor. So it depends on what kind of dish you're making. And I'm no a chef by any means. I personally like them fresh. I just eat them, you know, straight bowl of them. I love them on a sandwich, super easy on a sandwich. Throw them on top of a nice salad or on top of a soup. They're really, really great. And there's a ton of other varieties. So, I mean, there's a lot of other things. So think of it this way. This is kind of an easy way to describe it. Is any plant that you eat the leaf of or the stem of, so like broccoli, great example. We eat the leaves and the stems of those. If you eat the actual plant, so we don't eat tomato plants or cucumber plants. So those are not seeds that we would eat sprouts on. But on lettuces or beans or broccoli, alfalfa, all of those are great sprouts. And there's, like I said, a huge selection out there. These are just some of the ones that we picked initially, kind of because they're the most popular and easy to start with. And there's a lot of different grades in them as well. But my most important thing about the seeds is just find a high quality seed so you don't have to worry about anything other than getting them to grow, which is super, super easy. And so that's what we're going to talk about next, is the 6 rules of sprouting. And this is what makes it so simple. There's only 6 rules. You know, I can think of probably 100 rules if we're talking about growing, you know, a shrub or something. But it's only 6 rules for growing sprouts. So the first one is soak. So we're going to soak our seeds. That kind of, you know, think about back into your elementary days, or if you've got kids, you know, putting a seed in a wet paper towel. And that's what gets it to germinate. So soaking is really kind of a very, very important step. And all seeds are going to need to be soaked. And the really cool thing about these seed packets, too, is it gives you kind of all the information right here on the front. So it's really, really easy to kind of follow that. And we'll talk about that as we kind of go through some of them. So let's see. I think Kathleen said, I've had radish, mustard, broccoli in the mix. Yep, they're awesome. So soak is one of the first rules. The next one is rinse often. So we're going to want to rinse them pretty consistently. And that's kind of an important thing to kind of keep them from mildewing or molding. And then we're going to keep moist. So we want to keep them moist, but we don't want to keep them wet. So soaking and then keeping moist are two different things. And I'll show you that here in a second. Keep them at room temperature, so 72 degrees. So you can keep them just in a normal room. Most homes are somewhere between 68 and 74 degrees. Right? So even through the winter season, you might get a little bit warmer. Those might fluctuate, but you got a pretty big window there of temperatures. And they're all just room temperature. So room temperature is super, super easy. Give them plenty of room to breathe. Don't put too many in the container. So that's another important thing. And we'll talk about that as I show you how to kind of do this, as to how to not put too many in, because that was one of my first mistakes that I made, was I put way too many in. Now it still turned out okay, but we want to be careful not to breed kind of any kind of disease or mold or mildew that can, one, harm us, but also just kind of take the taste away and not make them taste as good and not as fresh for sure. And then the last one is keep them covered, no light. So we don't want any light with these. I'll show you a little example of ones that are sprouting with light, so you'll actually see kind of the difference. So really, really easy to do. 6 simple rules: soak, rinse, keep moist, not wet, keep them at room temperature, give them room to breathe, and keep them covered with no light. And don't worry, you don't have to take notes. All of these notes will be provided once we get a minute to kind of post this video to our website. You can always go back and check on it. And you can always watch these videos that we've taped in the past, and they all have notes with them as well. All right, so now there's 2 different methods to growing? Well, there's probably a lot of methods. I've seen people grow them in bags. That's more for like if you're going hiking or you're gonna be kind of camping out and you still wanna grow some sprouts. But there's two really kind of popular methods, and it's the jar method or the tray method. And the jar method is very, very easy. I'm gonna show you that one next. The first one I'm gonna show you is the tray method, which is also very easy, and that's the fun thing about this. It's fun for all ages, and it's super, super easy. So this is a kitchen crop sprouter. So this is one that we carry right now. And there's a lot of different styles of these, and you'll see a lot of different ones. You can see the picture there on the side. And basically what they are is a small strainer on the inside that's gonna hold the seed in, allow the moisture to come out, but also give the seeds plenty of space. So it's gonna allow you to grow four different crops at one time. So you can see the different levels here. So you can grow four different crops. So you can grow a lot in a small space too. That's the cool thing. And you can do them at different stages. So you don't have them all coming at the same time. You start one layer and then you start another layer 2 or 3 days later. And then that way you've got a consistent kind of crop. However, I will say the jar method is super, super easy. I'm gonna show you that here in a second. But this is a great method. This one actually comes with a little bit of seed. I think it's lentil, I think it's alfalfa. So you get a little packet of alfalfa seeds with this, and it's a really, really easy setup. So it's a really cool little setup. And I've got one over here that's actually started, so I can actually demonstrate how to do this. So what I like to do with this is I'll take these two layers off so we don't see those. So I'm gonna show you how to start one here. And we'll start with, let's do some radish. So we'll do some radish because they look nice. So I'm just gonna rip off the top. The cool thing about these bags of seed too is that they're resealable. And they'll actually stay pretty fresh and really usable and be able to germinate for a high amount of time. So I'm talking maybe 2 to 3 years you can actually get these to germinate. So this is a really, really nice way of storing them in this little container. So I've got four different layers here. We've got some different ones here, and you can see a little bit of moisture coming out. So I got a bowl over here. I'm just gonna pour this water out because I have been growing some in here, so you can see. Now, what you can do is for the soaking period, you can actually soak them in the bottom. So this bottom container has no holes, so that's gonna keep your counter nice and dry. It's just a solid plastic container. So if I'm gonna soak them, I'm gonna put them in here, and you can put a fair amount. I like to do about a tablespoon, maybe a half a tablespoon, but for these tray methods, you just want to fill up the bottom without having it too, too tight. So I'll show you this as I get done. So you can see that right there. So that's pretty good right there. It's coating the bottom. I don't want to fill it up. I don't want to pile in there. So for the tray method, you just want kind of a solid base, and you don't want to go too, too packed for sure. That's kind of a nice little assortment. You can still see the bottom through it. So it's just kind of nice and spaced out. They're just really settled. It's almost one layer. We don't want to kind of have another layer on top. That would be too many. So what I can do here, the first step is soak. So we're just going to take and pour the water in here. And if I were at the sink, if I was in a kitchen, I would do this right in the sink, no problems at all. That's the cool thing about this too, compared to microgreens, is we don't have to worry about the type of water we're using. I know some seed packets might say non-chlorinated or let your water sit out, excuse me, for a day, which is not a bad practice in general, is to let some water sit out. It's great for houseplants, but for seed starting or for soaking, you can just pour some tap water in there. It's not a problem at all. If you're concerned about it, you can always use bottled water if you want to, or use filtered water. I mean, I've got a Brita filter, you can filter it, and then that way you know you're a little bit safer if you want to, but you don't have to worry about it. It's super, super easy. So what I want to do is cover up the seed with water. So I don't know if you can quite see that, but I've got enough water in there that it's covering the seed, and then it can just soak. So as I'm kind of building my layers, so let's say I've got another layer, like this one, for example. So this one's a little bit further along. You can see those sprouts coming along there. So that one could go on top, and then I could keep building up layers. So I can do, I can start my soaking, and then I can have four other layers germinating. You want to soak for about 6 to 8 hours. So about 6 to 8 hours, maybe 10 hours, depending on the seed. So every seed packet, like I mentioned, recommends the amount of soak hours. So we were doing radishes. So the radish says 8 to 12 hours. So we do want to soak those a little bit longer. The longer soak time means it's probably got a thicker seed coating, so we're going to want to break that down a little bit more. So what I like to do is just let it sit overnight. I'll start them at night before I go to bed. In the morning, I'll wake up and I'll rinse them. So let's pretend that these have soaked for about 8 to 12 hours. So then all I want to do is just rinse them off. So I've got a little empty bowl over here that I'll put here so I can do all my kind of mixing in front of it. So then I've got an empty tray. These have soaked for 8 to 12 hours, and I'm just going to pour it in this tray. And this is a strainer, so it's a solid base, and it's got, you can maybe see these drips of water coming off right around the edges. So it's got a bunch of little holes all the way around the edge. I'll show you how to do this here in a second. I'm actually going to set this off to the side. And then I'm going to, because a lot of seed gets stuck to the bottom here, so we'll just pour a little bit more water in and give that a little swish around. So we'll swish this around so we can get all the seeds off the bottom, and then we can pour it in there. And then what I like to do is, if you leave it like this, that's perfectly fine. You can leave it like this, you can put them on the tray, and then your basin is now going to become your catch, your water catch. And so that's perfectly fine. But what I like to do is I want to rinse them. So this is where we soak and then we rinse, and we're going to rinse often. So what I like to do is turn it to the side, and you're going to see that water is going to come out a little bit faster. So then I can really just kind of tilt this around, and I can get a little bit more pressure so that water is coming out a little bit faster. So if we just give it a little bit of a 45 degree angle tilt, then you get a little bit more quick washout. And so then I can take it and put it in the sink and really rinse it out. So you're going to want to rinse it about maybe two or three times is typically what I do. So I'll rinse it about two or three times, and then any of the excess water, so then I'll just kind of spread these back out again. Let's pretend that I've rinsed them two or three times. So I'm just going to spread them back out, and it's okay if they're on top of each other. So you can see right here, some of them are clumped up a little bit. That's okay. That's not a problem. Any of the excess water is going to slowly but surely drip out, and then it'll work its way down through the entire system. So if I've got some that are sprouted or some that are 2 or 3 weeks ago, then they're just going to work, all the water is going to work down. It's going to work down right along the edge too. So it doesn't matter what stage they're at, which level they're at. It really doesn't matter, just as long as you know. And I'll tell you kind of how to identify. What I like to do is take a little sticky note sometimes and put a little sticky note on there with the date that I started them, because it'll tell me how many days. So for radish seeds, it says 5 to 6 days to harvest. So that's not a whole lot of time. We're talking 8 to 12 hours to soak and then 5 to 6 days to harvest. There's also a great little spreadsheet that I'll put in our notes that tells you all about like the length. Because then that's personal preference, and this is where I get to that trial and error part, is you're going to taste them and you're going to kind of see what length you let them at. Some people like their sprouts small and more on the younger side, and then some like them a little bit older when they get a little bit longer. And most of them are going to range somewhere between the half an inch to maybe 2 inches size. So it really just depends on personal preference there. But then what I can do is I'm going to let these soak. And then, or I've let them soak and then I've rinsed them. I want to rinse them two or three times. Now, then you want to rinse them two or three times. Now, this is kind of an important thing that I've learned through my trial and error, is I find that rinsing them the first day, so we've soaked them overnight, and then the first rinse, you're going to see kind of that water is not going to be crystal clear, right? So it's going to have a little bit of kind of like either a brownish or greenish kind of color to it. And that means that the seed coating is breaking down, but we're also cleaning the seed. And that's what the rinsing is doing, is cleaning it and adding some moisture back in. But we want to make sure we strain it really well. So what I find is the first day, I like to try and get two or three rinses in. So about, spread them out throughout the day. I usually do it in the morning before I leave to go to work, and then I do it when I come home, and then I do it again before I go to bed. And that's just the first day. Pretty much after that, I've just been doing two rinses a day, morning and evening. And that really, really seems to be perfectly fine. But that first day, you're going to see a little bit of that water not being as clear coming out of that rinse. So that means that you're washing off the seed and you're cleaning it and you're getting it re-moistened again. So that's as simple as it is. And then basically, you're just going to cover it. So that's the next important thing. So let's move this water out of the way. So we're just going to put all of our layers back on. I've got the radish down here at the bottom, and then I've got an empty tray, and then I've got some that are a little bit older, and then I've got the top one. And the top one has a top. So that's gonna help darken it up a little bit. So we've just got it like that. And then what I like to do at home, because I really like my seed in a lot of darkness, is I'll take a dish towel, or sometimes I'll put it up in a cabinet. That's what I do with the jar method. And I got this a little wet, so it looks a little wet. But basically, you can just cover it like that. Really, really simple way of doing it. And that keeps all the light from penetrating the sides, because the sides of this are somewhat see-through. And that helps you kind of see what stage they're at and kind of keep an eye on them. But this is a great way of just keeping all the darkness out, or put them in a cabinet, or put them in a dark room that you don't have many windows, closet, a cupboard, wherever you want, that is gonna get kind of complete darkness. Because let's think about the life cycle of a seed, right? So a seed is underneath the ground. When it germinates, it stays underground. So it's developing those first initial pieces of growth, and they're underneath the ground. They're not ready for light. So we don't want to expose it to a lot of light initially. I'll talk about how you can expose it to some light at the end. So very, very easy to do. Just keep it nice and dark, like a plant, like a seed would be underneath the ground. So if you were growing a seed in soil, it'd be dark under there, and the plant would be just starting to kind of start with its tendrils, start coming out. And as it germinates, that part of that plant is going to be underneath the ground. And so we want to keep it in a dark condition. It's too early in its life cycle to get much light. So what happens if you get a little bit of light? Well, this one actually, I put in a little bit of light to germinate it. And you're going to see there, you're going to see some green. So those little green leaflets that are starting to form are pretty early in its stage. And that's not horrible. It's not bad. It's not going to be a bad sprout, but it's still too much light for the plant. We're kind of harming the plant by doing that. This is about 3 or 4 days after being rinsed, for 3 or 4 days. And this is the salad mix. And you can see how those sprouts are very, very white. I mean, they don't have any green on them at all. And they're actually pretty close to being eaten. So about 3 to 4 days, 5 to 6 days, depends on the type of seed. So really, really easy. But as you can see, if you expose them to light, they're going to start to put those green leaves out so that it thinks it's, you know, at the top of the soil level, and you want to let them grow out a little bit. You want the sprout part of it. So really, really easy to do, and the cover really makes it nice. And it's all machine washable, so you can put it in the dishwasher when you're done. You can take out each layer. It's super, super easy. But I like to just cover it with a dish towel and let it stay in complete darkness when I'm not rinsing them. So basically all the time. All right, so then what we can do is give them plenty. So rinse, we're gonna keep rinsing. That's it, rinse and repeat. So we're soaking and rinsing, and then you just refer to your package when they're ready to harvest. And like I said, this one is really, really close. So this is that salad mix. So they're about 2 to 3 inches, or sorry, about 1 to 2 inches, not quite 3 inches. And we can let them get a little bit bigger. And what I like to do is I like to put them in a little bit of sunlight so they get a little bit of green on them. But super tasty, crunchy, you know, that very, very much a lettuce kind of taste. So really, really nice. That's the salad mix. So it tastes like salad, really. It's awesome. I like them just fresh like that, but they're awesome on sandwiches and salads and soups. So a really, really easy way to do it is the tray method. And you can do this a lot of different ways. I've seen people, you know, take just a plate, and they'll put them in a colander. Just make sure your colander has very, very tiny holes, because a lot of these seeds are very small, and so the seeds can go through. So you want to make sure to rinse them in a colander, and then you can lay them back out on a plate, cover them with a towel, or cover them with another plate is not a bad option. Just flip the plate over upside down, and you've got yourself a little dark spot for you to grow them in. Some people will lay them out on a paper towel so that they have some moisture, but they're not sitting in water. So there's a lot of different ways of doing it. With the tray method, is really, really easy. Now I'm going to show you the jar method. So the jar method is another great way. So this is our jar here. I'm going to show you how we get to this point real easily. Lots of different ways to do these. Now with the jar method, all you need is a jar. You can actually do this with cheesecloth, but I love these lids. So these lids are also from Handy Pantry. So this is a sprout lid. Very, very easy. And so I'm just gonna pull this out to show you. It's basically a plastic lid with a ton of little tiny holes in it. Too small for the seed to come out of, but enough for water to come out of. So it's a really, really easy way of doing this. And these fit on wide mouth jars. So here's a wide mouth jar. If I was gonna do the cheesecloth method, which I don't mind. It's not my favorite because this I can reuse over and over again. Usually with the cheesecloth, I like to throw it away after I do it with that. So you can put a piece of cheesecloth over it and then put your metal ring back on top or use a rubber band just to keep that cheesecloth in there. The problem is every time you go to water it and drain it and rinse it, it's a little bit of a pain to kind of work with. So that's why I love these little plastic tops. You can also find these in stainless steel. There's lots and lots of different options out there. But you definitely are going to need a wide mouth jar. So this is a wide mouth jar. So the first thing we're going to do is soak. And that's why I love the jar method, is because one crop in here, very, very easy to do. What I have found is it's hard to do, let's do this larger, the protein powerhouse. I found it very hard to not measure it in the jar method. So the first time I did it, I just kind of poured some seed in there. You know, the fine seed, this little five-part salad mix, has a ton of little tiny seeds in it. And so you put it in there and you're like, that's hardly anything. And that's what's so cool about this, is you're gonna produce a lot. In fact, on your package, it's gonna tell you the yield is 1 to 5. So if you put in a tablespoon of this five-part salad mix of these smaller seeds, then it's gonna develop 5 times the size of that. So this right here, these sprouts, which are still a little bit, probably another day from being actually edible, maybe a day, maybe 2 days, this is gonna get a little bit bigger. I mean, this is 1 tablespoon is almost gonna fill up this jar. So be careful, don't add too much. I sometimes do 1.5 tablespoons, just depends. You're gonna play with it and kind of trial and error again. So let's do this protein powerhouse. Now this is a 1 to 2 yield, so they're not gonna get quite as big. So I'm gonna take this tablespoon, this measuring spoon, and just put in 2 tablespoons of the protein powerhouse in this one, and that's it. And then I'm just gonna fill it with water. Now, you fill it with water, this is why I also love the jar method, is you just wanna make sure it's completely covered. So let's say that was almost about enough seeds to fill up the bottom. And so I'm just gonna make sure that I got plenty of water in there. It doesn't really, really matter. And another great thing that I forgot to add was make sure it's cool water. We don't wanna use warm tap water. We don't want to use lukewarm water. We really want cool water, especially when we're rinsing. But even when we're soaking, just use cool water. It's going to get to room temperature. That's perfectly fine. So this one is a 8 to 12 hour soak time. So we're going to soak this. So you can see the seed there. It's about, I don't know, let's say 1/2 inch deep of seed. And so I've got about 3 inches of water, which is perfect. So we want about 4 to 5 times the amount of water on top of it, just to make sure it soaks. And sometimes I'll get a little swish, but just to make sure that it's completely kind of mixed up and that water has kind of encompassed all those seeds. And we're just gonna leave this for 8 to 12 hours. Now, when we get to the rinsing part, this is important. So when we're gonna drain this, so this is soaked for 8 to 12 hours. This cap is really cool, but the first time I used it, I was kind of confused because I went like this. And you can see no water comes out. And that's because the force is evenly spread out across these little tiny holes, and so it actually holds the water in. But if you turn it to the side, it just drains out. So that's really kind of an important step. It's got all these little tiny little nodes on the top of this top. So when you rest it on a countertop, it doesn't sit directly on the countertop. So it does allow some moisture to come out if you want, but you're gonna find better that that when you turn it to the side on a 45 degree angle, it's gonna drain really, really well. So these have soaked for 8 to 12 hours. I'm gonna rinse them, and I wanna rinse them about 2 to 3 times. So we're just gonna, again, if I was at a kitchen sink, I wouldn't even have to take the top off. I could just put it right onto the tap, and the water's gonna go right in through that lid, and then I can just shake it, and I'm done. So really, really easy. All right, so this is what I like to do, is just give them a little bit of a swish around. So we're just gonna take this and just give it a little bit of a kind of swish. I don't wanna be too harsh on it. And that's important when we get to this. So I'm actually gonna rinse these so you can see what to do there. But that's actually got, you know, the leaf, or the plant is actually starting to come out of the seed there. And so I wanna be careful not to disrupt that or hurt that and break them all apart. So we're just gonna give them a gentle swish and then pour it out. And I like to do that about two to three times for the first day, and then 2 times after that. Real, real easy. And then I like to just store them, and again, in a cupboard. What I have found is find yourself a little bowl or a glass like Pyrex baking pan. It could be anything that holds water. I found that just a little Tupperware works perfectly fine, and you just put it in like that. So now it's sitting at an angle. I don't want it sitting like this. So in the jar method with this top specifically, now cheesecloth drains a little bit better, but this top really works well at an angle. It works the best at an angle. So that's why I like this little Tupperware, is because it holds it at that perfect angle. So I don't have to do anything, and it catches any excess water. And so when I go to get it about 8 to 10 hours later to kind of rinse it again, I can just dump out the water and then I can rinse it and put it back in here. It's really, really easy. And then I just put it in my cupboard. So I just put it in my cupboard and then I don't worry about it again. I don't have to worry about covering it with a dish towel. If you want to do it on your countertop, then just cover it with a dish towel or something. But make sure it's getting lots of dark space. So that's how you're going to do it as those seeds germinate. So as those seeds start to break open, then you're going to get more of this. Now again, if I were at a kitchen sink, I would just put the tap right on top. If you hold the tap too far away from the top, it tends to kind of spill over the edges. So we want good pressure to get it through these little tiny holes. So I usually put it right up against the bottom of the tap there, turn it on, cold water, and then rinse it. Now, because I don't have, I'm not at a kitchen sink here, I'm just going to take and rinse it with this water from this nice clean watering can. And usually what I will do is I will fill this up pretty much almost to the top when I'm rinsing, because I'm at a tap and I've got plenty of access to water. Here I might not use all my water. I got a couple other watering cans I can use. So we'll use up some of that. And I'm going to put a little bit more in just so you can really see how this works. Because as these seeds start to germinate and get a little bit bigger, then you're definitely going to want to rinse them really, really well and make sure they're good and rinsed. And I do this, like I said, about 2 or 3 times at the sink, but I do like it pretty full. So we'll fill that up, and then I'm just gonna put the top back on. If I were to kitchen sink, it'd still be on. And then I'm just gonna give it a light little shake. Now again, I don't wanna shake it too much. I don't wanna break apart these little sprouts. They're fairly fragile. They're not super fragile, but they're fairly fragile. And so I don't wanna break them apart too much. And then I'm just gonna turn it to the side. You can see all that water coming out. And then usually what I like to do here is I will turn it slightly as I let it rinse out, as I let the water drain out. And it kind of helps get some of the seeds kind of broken up, because when you start to see them germinate, you know, all those little tendrils will start to work into each other and create kind of this mass here. And so I do want to kind of loosen that up. And so I'll kind of give it a little bit of a shake to try and flatten it out, because again, we want them to have space. So we want them to be able to breathe some. So I'll give it a little bit of a shake, and then there we go. And then make sure it's drained and really, really rinsed off really well. And then I put it back in my Tupperware and I'm good to go. Now at about this point, when they get to the size that you like, which really could be anywhere between 1/2 inch to 2 to 3 inches long. And what I'm talking about there is each little kind of piece of growth. So we'll open this up here so I can show you a little bit better on that. So here we go. This looks like a radish. So you can see that's about maybe 1 inch. And that's a pretty good little length right there for that radish seed. And it tastes just like a little radish. I mean, so it's great, really, really easy, and they're super, super tasty. So about at this level, I might take it and try and green it up, because when you green it up, you actually get some chlorophyll in there, which is very, very healthy for you. I mean, that's why we eat our lettuces and our leafy greens for those extra vitamins. So I'll just take it just like this and put it in a window for about 4 to 6 hours. This is about all it needs. It doesn't need a whole day, it doesn't need a whole lot, and you don't want to put it in direct light. So I'll usually put it in a east-facing window. I'll put it in there. It doesn't need a whole lot of light. You can just pull it out on your countertop if it's a well-lit room. So you don't want to put it directly in full blazing sun. It can burn them up. These are very young plants. So we want to just let them form those new leaves and start to green up a little bit. And then once you get a little bit more green on them, then they're super, super tasty, and they taste even better, I think. Now, some people don't like them as much when they green up, and that's perfectly fine. You might like them just like this. So it's really personal preference. Try it both ways. Take some out, eat them if you like them. Try some in a window, get them to green up a little bit, and I think you'll love them that way as well. So it really just depends on how you're doing it. Now, so harvesting is, you know, anywhere between, it just depends on the package. So every package is going to tell you. So like a chia seed is going to be 10 to 15 days. So a little bit longer. A lentil is a little bit bigger of a seed, but it's harvested in 2 to 4 days. So it really just depends on the type of seed. I like the mixes that are pre-mixed. So sometimes it'll say mix as well with other sprouts, so you can make your own mixes if you want to. But I like to buy the pre-mixed ones because I know all these seeds are gonna germinate somewhere in that same time frame and are very, very easy to kind of and complement each other. So I kind of rely on the experts to give me the mix that I want. But the more and more that I do this, the more and more I will feel better probably about making my own mixes. But super, super easy. When you harvest, there's a couple different tricks that you can do here. I'm not gonna show you here because I don't really have a kitchen sink and that's really what I would need. But sometimes I'll just take a bowl and I'll pour these in the bowl, because if you look at this jar, you'll see all these little brown seed casings. Now those are not ungerminated seeds. That's actually the casing that was on the outside of the seed, and they'll come off. You can eat them, it's personal preference. A lot of times I don't mess with it too much. What I like to do is I'll reach in here and grab the whole bunch out, and then all those little seeds that are stuck to the side, the seed coatings that are stuck to the side, I don't know if you can see those, but there you go, look at the bottom. So see all those little seed coatings that are stuck right there, all that brown? That some people don't like to eat. Another great method that is really, really easy is just take them, put them in a bowl, like a solid bowl, not a strainer, and put all your sprouts in there and give them one last rinse. All of the seed coatings that are kind of loose and floating around will float to the top, and you can kind of, all of your sprouts are gonna kind of bind together, and then you can literally just push them right off the top. So I'll just let the water flow till the point where it's at the top or even overflowing out of the bowl, and those seed coatings will just kind of fill out over the top. Or if you've got a bowl with a little spout on the side of it, works really, really well. You can find lots of different methods there. Then what I like to do is strain them again one more time. So I'll strain them one more time. I'll put them on a paper towel, let them sit for maybe an hour, and then I can put them in a Ziploc bag, or I can put them back in the jar and store them in the fridge. And they'll store for about 4 to 6 days. Usually when I get to about day 7, I typically say that they're not worth storing much anymore. But you can store them for about 4 to 6 days. If they start to lose some of that green color that you really, really like maybe, you can put them back in a somewhat of a indirect light inside your house, and they'll green back up in a few hours and you can eat them. So they're really, really easy. And then I think I've got 2 or 3 of these jars right now, and so I can kind of have different crops going at different times. It's a lot of fun, it's super easy. I love this jar method, it's great. I've got a family of 4, so it feeds us really, really well, and they're a great addition to all of our snacks, and I'll just sit there as a snack and eat them, especially the bigger seeds. So like the garbanzo and the zuki, some of these bigger seeds, I like them just eating them straight. Some people might put some lemon pepper on them, a little bit of lemon juice, but they're really, really easy and they just taste great. And the bigger seeds have a little bit more of a nutty flavor, whereas the smaller ones have more of that leafy green flavor. They're a lot of fun, super easy. So let's talk about one last time what you wanna do. Let's make sure I got through all my notes. So you know, clean them off in a bowl, let them dry as much as possible before you store them. You can store them in a plastic bag or a jar for up to 4 to 6 days. Very, very easy. I'm going to get some of your questions here in a second. The last thing I want to do is just talk about the main steps. Soak them, look at your seed packet. It'll tell you how many hours to soak them. Most of them are gonna be somewhere between 6 and 12 hours. I usually say around about 8 hours is kind of the kind of general average time. So that's usually about how many hours we sleep. So put them in some water, soak them overnight, wake up in the morning, rinse them 2 to 3 times, and then rinse them 2 to 3 times that day. So each time I go to rinse, I'm gonna fill this up 2 or 3 times, rinse them out really good, pour it out, whether I'm in this sprouting tray or whether I'm in the jar, rinse them out, make sure that's an important thing. I think the first day after you've soaked them, to rinse them about 2 or 3 times. And then after that, rinse 2 times a day for the rest until you get to the harvest time frame. And you can always taste them. So if you're kind of like, ooh, I don't know if these are quite ready yet. So like this is a great example. So these little guys that I actually exposed to a little bit of light. So let's see, I don't know if they're quite ready. Just taste them. They taste pretty good. So they're actually probably getting pretty close. And it just depends. You might say, now I know what they taste like. Let me give them a little bit longer. Really, really great. And very, very easy. So we're gonna rinse and then we're gonna harvest. And what I like to do before I harvest them is give them a little bit of indirect light for 4 to 6 hours, and then you can store them or eat them fresh as a snack right there at your harvest time frame. So really, really easy, super, super simple. They're great little sprouts. They're super nutritional. And it's just a fun thing to do. And my kids love it. So I mean, even if the kids can eat it, and my wife loves them, and it's just a very, very beneficial thing and super easy, something that I can grow year round without any problems. So now I'll answer all of your questions, and because I know I got kind of on a roll there and I didn't want to stop too much. And I know we were having some little connection issues there, I think I saw, so I just decided to kind of keep on going. So I know Carol said the video had stopped. I think we had fixed that. Do you also do or recommend microgreens? Kathleen, yes, microgreens are awesome. They're amazing. They are a little bit more complicated. And I don't sell a lot of microgreen seeds. Now, some of these you can grow, like the sunflower, you can grow as microgreens, and a lot of these you probably can. Radishes are real popular. Beets are real popular for microgreens, and they're very, very easy, but then there's the hydroponic method and there's a soil method. So there's two different ways to do it. The hydroponic, you need these specific mats to grow them in and a tray, and you gotta pH balance your water. That's probably the most important thing because it's gonna sit in some water consistently. So it's not like this where you're just rinsing it and then you're repeating that, where you don't have to worry about your pH in water because you're just re-moisting them. We're just trying to get them to germinate. With microgreens, we're actually trying to get them to a point to harvest them. And then you gotta be worried about whether you're doing soil or whether you're doing it with the mat. I'm not saying it's impossible, it's super, super easy. I definitely recommend getting into it. In fact, this handy pantry company, the True Leaf Market, actually has a great website devoted to all things microgreens, wheatgrass, catgrass, sprouts, really, really cool little website. But what we're starting with today and what we're gonna be doing for probably the next few months is sprouts, and then we'll look at doing some microgreens in the future. So we haven't started that yet. I've never actually grown a batch of microgreens. I've eaten them, of course. They're awesome and very, very healthy. And they're easy to do. So definitely, you know, tune in the future. We'll probably be doing them soon. Looks like we might have had some scammers out there. Sorry about there. Yep, so Janice, just a simple towel to cover them is a great way to keep them in the dark. I like to put them in the cupboard. I just find that easy. I, you know, made my wife get rid of some of her water bottles that she has too many of, and I just put it up in the cupboard and they just store right there, and then I don't have to worry about covering them. But if you're doing it on your countertop, if that helps you remember, because sometimes, you know, you do say, oh, out of sight, out of mind. So putting them on your counter is fine. Just cover them with a dish towel. Super, super easy. So Elaine said, sorry, I missed the first part. Where do we get the seeds? So if you live in our neck of the woods, we hope you come and see us here at McDonald Garden Center. We carry all of these seeds here at the McDonald Garden Center. But if you go online, you can order them yourself from the company. It's called True Leaf Market or Handy Pantry if you look them up online. So you can see right there at the top of the bag, Handy Pantry or True Leaf Market. Really cool. And just click on sprouts, sprouting seeds, and they carry all of these lids. They carry the sprout kitchen crop. So they carry this guy, all the little lids. I don't know if they have the jars, but you know, all you need is a wide mouth jar. Really, really easy to find these at any craft store anywhere. You probably have some around your house. It's just, it's gotta be a wide mouth to fit this lid. So that's the only important, and I think it's actually easier to work with a wide mouth jar, because these sprouts will get kind of big and they'll really fill up the jar, and you wanna be able to get them out easily. And yes, Elena, after the video is done, we'll have the notes posted and we'll have it on our website. If you go to mcdonaldgardencenter.com, all of our videos are up there. You just click on my tab, it's the Garden Guru tab, and you can scroll down and you can watch all the videos in the past. You can also check out our YouTube channel. They're all on there as well. Kathleen said, depends where you live. If you're near the garden, they have them online, Amazon. Oh, so you're answering. Thank you. Thank you for answering my questions. Robin said, I'm in Virginia Beach and we'll be at your garden center on Independence next Monday. Where do I find the seeds once I get there? So they're back with our regular seeds. So if you've ever been here at the Independence store, is what you mentioned, they're going to be right back in the left-hand corner of the greenhouse in our garden supply section with all of our regular seed packets. So, you know, with our peas and beets and corn and salad seeds. You'll find all of these little sprouting seeds as well. They're really, really easy. Fun, pick up a couple, you know, start with some bigger ones, some smaller ones, and try them out. I really love the mixes because it gives you a good selection of different seeds to try. But lots of people love alfalfa, the chia, let's see what else we got, the mung bean, really, really easy to do. And they're lots and lots of fun. And we've got a great selection right now at both locations. So whether you're here at the independent store or at our great next door, we've got a great selection. What is the average size of the seed packets? 8 ounces. Also, approximately what's the average price? Great question. So most of them are 8 ounces to 4 ounces. So these little small bags are 4 ounces. And then this is our 8 ounce bag. And then this is, I think, 8 ounces too, just bigger seed. So this is the 8 ounce, 4 ounce. And those are typically the sizes. And you're only using about a tablespoon, maybe 2 tablespoons. Depends on how much you want to do. But in the trays, you'll use a little bit more because you'll fill up a little bit more, and you've got 4 different options there of being able to grow different layers. With the jar method, I find a tablespoon and play with it. Depends on the seeds, and it depends on that yield. The yield is an important thing to look at. So down here on the package, it's going to tell you the serving size, which is 1/4 cup. I wouldn't worry about that too much. But what they're saying there is a serving size is how much you get all the benefits, you know, all the different nutrients. The yield is a 1-to-2, 1-to-4, 1-to-5 ratio, and that means that you're actually going to get 5 times the amount or twice the amount, depending on the yield. And then it gives you your soak time, your rinse and drain, which is always 2 to 3 times a day, and then your harvest, 2 to 4 days. All of ours are USDA organic, non-GMO, really, really high quality seeds. Oh, and the price. I forgot the price. So the price is usually $4.99 to about $14.99 for the black chia. So some of the harder ones to get, like the Chinese cabbage, they were out of that one at the time. It's also not a USDA certified organic seed. So I kind of went with all USDA organic. Some of them are actually heirloom as well. Somewhere between $4.99, $7.99, to up to, I think this is our most expensive pack, the chia is $14.99. But that makes a lot. It's a yield of 1-to-7. So 1 tablespoon is gonna develop into filling up almost this entire jar. So that one part is gonna become 7 parts. So it's really, really amazing. So whenever you see a higher yield, a 1-to-7, 1-to-5, then only start with a small amount. I mean, you might even do 1/2 tablespoon of the black chia. Let's see if I've got another example here. Let's see, the mung bean. The mung bean is a 1-to-2 and a 2-to-5 day harvest, and they are $4.99. So lots of great selection here, and really inexpensive. I mean, if you go to buy fresh sprouts from a high-end grocery store, you're looking at probably $4.99 to $7.99 for a cup, maybe 2 cups, depends. And this is, you're gonna pay that same amount, and you can fill this jar up, probably 5 to 10 times from one packet of seeds. This is my original, let's see if I've got it here somewhere. This is my original 5-part salad mix, and this is what the packet looked like. So this is the one I've been growing at home. See if I can find the full packet. So there's the full packet. So you can see I'm down to about here, and this is a full packet. So I've got about maybe 1 ounce left out of a 4-ounce bag. I've got about, I've used 3 ounces, and I've grown probably 10 jars of this already, of that salad mix. Been lots and lots of fun, very easy. All right. So Kathleen said, I like the jar method. I had done microgreens with a dark tray and covering using core. The problem with that is the core has to be replaced all the time. But we didn't have to do all the rinsing. We just misted them. And that's true, Kathleen. So microgreens and sprouts are completely different. Sprouts were really just kind of letting them just kind of explode with all those nutrients and germinate, and maybe put a little leaf on it if they want to, that first kind of leaf set, if we want to push them a little bit further. Microgreens are really, we're growing it to leaf size. And so that involves a little bit more time covering them, because initially they need to be in the dark, just like the sprouts do. But then as we eat the sprouts, the microgreens, then you've got to start exposing them to light. And it's going to be in a tray. It's going to be an 11 by 22, something like that. Your standard 10 by 20 tray. And you're going to have to put some sort of light on them, whether it's natural light or an LED or a grow light. So then that's where it gets not super complicated. Microgreens are awesome and healthy and easy, but sprouts are for us beginners and for us that want something quick and easy and simple and healthy. Sprouts are very, very easy. So yes, the jar method is great, and you don't have to replace anything. All you need is water. You don't need soil. You just need a container. Really, really easy. But you don't have to do the rinsing. You just missed. I know. I agree. So Carly said she was answering the questions about watching the video. And let's see if we've got. Laura said, thanks for all the great info. Deborah said, would you be able to repurpose, disperse, use water to water plants? Of course. So Deborah, that is a great question. So I can take all of this disposable water and take it and put it right on plants. It's not gonna hurt anything. It's completely fine. I wouldn't drink it. I wouldn't use it that way. But you can definitely use it for plants. So Deborah, great call. And Deborah also asked, do you carry the Christmas swags in the fall? So we're gonna start putting out our Christmas decorations in the next probably 2 to 3 weeks. So Deborah, give us a little bit of time and we'll get the swags out. Most of those wreaths and garlands and swags will come in. Now the artificial ones will be up probably by about mid to end of September. Give us a call, make sure we've got them in, because I know they're coming in like multiple shipments. But yes, we're starting to decorate for Christmas. I was mentioning fall stuff earlier, but Christmas is coming pretty soon too. Robin said, thank you, great. I've never grown sprouts, I'm excited to try them. You will love them. They're super easy. You'll have a lot of fun with them. Carol said, thank you for this video. All the great info. I wanted to do this for a long time, but was hesitant, a lack of knowledge. Excited to start my first sprouts. I was hesitant too, but you know what? With this jar method, I think it's a win-win. It's super easy, takes up hardly any space. It's very, very easy, and it's just kind of great for a small family. I mean, if I were doing, a lot of cooking with sprouts or really wanted a little bit more, then I might go to the tray method. I haven't started that yet. This was one that we actually did here at the garden center, but I love this jar method. I mean, I've got 2 jars already, and I think I'm going to get probably a third one soon and start trying some of these other ones, so it's been a lot of fun. Peggy said, I'm so thankful to have found your webinar and my feed for doing events. Thank you for doing what you do. I used the sprout years ago. I'm glad it's gained popularity again and is back. That makes organic seeds more available. Thank you so much, Garden Guru. Well, thank you, Peggy. Jennifer said, I've been on the event page for an hour waiting for this class to start. Sorry if it didn't work. Jennifer, if you want to, you can go back and view this video. At the end, we will have it posted. Robin said, thank you again. And she said, I don't trust sprouts from grocery stores. And it's just expensive. I mean, for $4.99, $7.99, even up to $14.99, and you can create your own sprouts, you grow them yourself, you can get them when you need them, you'll start to kind of figure it out. It doesn't take very long. You'll start to say, hey, this is when I like to harvest this type, and then you'll have them available to you whenever you want them. Kathleen said, I had the same problem. They might want to look into that. Okay, we will look into our internet connection. I apologize for that. All right, and then Kathleen said, I will get back on this new sprouts in the jar instead of microgreens. Sad I don't live near your store. Kathleen, I'm sorry too, but definitely, I mean, let's support this great company, Handy Pantry, True Leaf Market. So if you don't live in our neck of the woods, definitely go check them out. If you do, you can come and talk to us. You can ask us any even more questions. That's why we hope you'll support our local business. If you live locally, if you don't, then definitely go check them out. They're a small business as well, and they produce great stuff. So really, really cool. So if you're doing microgreens or you're frustrated with your summer vegetable garden, as we kind of wind down on that season, try some sprouts. They're super, super easy. They're a lot of fun, and you really can't mess it up. I mean, water, a container, rinse them. Just remember to rinse them. Keep them in a dark place, and you're done in about 3 to 4 to 5 days. You've got great sprouts, and you'll love them. They're super, super easy, great snack, and super nutritional. I mean, read all the benefits, and I'll get a link posted out there if you go to their website, True Leaf Market, and you click on their info, you can get some information. They've done videos in the past as well. Hopefully mine's a little better, but they do some videos, and they have a great pamphlet on sprouts. I'll make that available to you. Well, it's a lot. It's like 40 pages, but there's a great little part of that we'll post with our video as well. So hope everybody's doing well. Continue to garden and enjoy the fall weather as it starts. And we'll see you next week. If you got mole and vole issues, I'll be talking about mole and voles. And we hope to see you soon here at the Garden Center. Thanks everybody for joining. I hope you enjoyed this. Grow some sprouts and have some fun with it. All right, talk to y'all later.